Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming in. Just to keep kind of structure this entire piece, I thought a good way to do it probably would be, I have a bunch of questions around what I could see around the new spectrum. I'm happy to put that out and feel free to jump in and answer those. So if anybody has an answer to it, and if somebody else has a counterpoint to it or whatever, please feel free to this thing. So we'll go, I'm not literally going order-wise or targeting questions to individual people. It's more keeping it open on the forum. So feel free to jump in when you have a point of view on this. Yeah. So yeah, I mean, what a time to come in. And this is last 2 months, I think, instead of seeing each other face to face. I think last time I met Vignesh was another panel where we were sitting next to each other. And now it's sitting across screens and having this discussion. Things have drastically changed, right? So I wanted to, and I've been in a situation where, because we are an advertising agency and we handle a bunch of brands, I've been privy to the larger spectrum of the digital ecosystem, how it's been affected by COVID, right? So there are brands which have a digital brand that has gone to almost ground zero, where there is no work happening, say something like a Make My Trip, etc. Two, there is something like a Netflix, which is seeing a super high uptake. So in that bandwagon of things, if I have to put news media here at this point or regional news, where between a Make My Trip and a Netflix, where do you see that? Where do you see this fitting in the impact that COVID's had on news media?
So, I want to kick it off with a slightly broader perspective at a national level and also talk a little bit about regional. You know, sure. I would actually say on a relative basis, and also in terms of the mass of audience, news is probably even higher than Netflix. And I'll tell you the reason why. You know, one is everyone in this country is flocking to a destination to find out what the latest updates, how things are changing, what are the new rules, how the ground realities are changing at the country level, at their state level, at their local levels, what is happening in across the world, what kind of economy and all of it. And yeah, there in general, there has been a slew of news items beyond COVID also across the globe, as we've all seen. So I think that's a natural environment for pushing the news consumption significantly higher. Two, I think what has happened is, especially in context to digital, the distribution chains or the circulation chains of the traditional media platforms like the print or radio, for example, has they've been interrupted. They've been sort of stalled in most part of the country. And hence the primary source of information, which used to be by default print in a large part of the country, that has migrated. You know, and the third part is really about the whole interactiveness. People are scared, people are anxious, and then they need forums that where they are able to connect, where they are able to get some advice, questions, data which helps them take decisions and all of that. And so all of these three combined have actually rocketed the audience growth across the news networks. So, you know, in our case, for example, we've grown almost 50-60% month on month on most of our sites. In some cases, it's even higher, and I think that's my perspective, and that's how we see it, at least across our network.
Has everybody here seen an uptick in users entirely overall?
Yes. Yeah, so yeah. That's for sure. And I think one of the things I'd just like to add to what Puneet was saying, one is that yes, print was interrupted for a brief period, probably 2 to 3 weeks, due to the fake news which was going around that, you know, paper carries the virus and all that stuff. It's a very unfortunate situation. I used to keep asking everybody if paper carries the virus and how are you still dealing with cash? How are you still paying cash and getting cash? I mean, it makes no sense. I mean, when it's convenient for us, paper doesn't carry it. When it's not convenient for us, it carries it. So we used to argue with the RWAs and the works. But the good news is that I think print has come back, and print has also shown that, yes, we were, as a magazine media player, we were especially afraid that, you know, is the habit getting diluted or is the habit getting skipped? But I'm happy to say that we were away out of print for 3 weeks. And once we came back, we put out, we put out a questionnaire and all that in our magazine, in our website and all that. We got the feedback saying that we are waiting for you guys to come back, right? And we actually saw it. Even though shops were not open, people were willing to come to the morning points and pick up their copies. And even though the papers were not being allowed, newspapers and magazines were not being allowed to be distributed in the Residential Welfare Association, because thanks to the RWAs, people were coming out and picking it up. So that was an amazing reaffirmation that print is, at least it is still relevant in the minds of people. And that's one piece of good news that I want to share. The second is, just like Puneet was saying, both web as well as especially we use this opportunity to get more people moving onto the app. So we've had a 300% uptick on our app, and that's keeping on going up. So what we've done is, typically we've always been behind the paywall for the longest time. Magazine content has been behind the paywall, but we said, if you download the app for a month, you'll get the magazines for free. So what's happened is that people have come onto the app. Even from the site, they've come onto the app. And after a month, we are starting to see subscriptions getting converted. So that is the funnel approach has really worked good for us. And I think that says a lot. The third is engagement between the website and the app. The engagement levels on the app is 3x that of the website. And we've seen that, we've got quizzes and games and fun things that we've started, putting out there, which people are responding to very positively. We literally, our users are, about $2,000 a day is what they make when they answer some of these quizzes. The kind of response that we are getting, tens of thousands of our users responding to quizzes 3 times a day. I think that is something that we have understood. And those quizzes are actually based on the current news and, whatever is happening, including fake news, which we put out there saying that, this is fake news, this is the fact. And then we run a quiz about fake news and they kind of spot it out. It's been quite an extraordinary experience.
Thank you.
Yeah, we've seen also that our user base has increased tremendously. What we've seen is, yes, COVID news did do well. Everyone wanted to know what's happening around them. But local happenings of, things around them, that did very well. We had the reporter chain cover local NGOs. There were, people needed a platform to donate and they needed authentic causes to donate. There were many who felt that, this is the time to donate. And we were able to bring that platform to people where we were able to authenticate local, albeit small donation camps, but authentic ones that we could put out there and help the donations go through. That page that we put out there did very well. And also, of course, it is a scary situation, but we kept a lot of things light and positive, and that content did very well. And I think even now we see the trend that people do want to know nice things in life. They want to read about the nicer things, the funnier things.
Yeah.
So the lighter vein is doing well, has been doing well, and is continuing to do well.
Yeah, from Manorama Online side, what Kerala has a special different story to tell. So basically, our newspaper circulation was never affected because government made it amply clear that newspapers will be part of essential commodities and it has to be circulated and delivered. So it was pretty much helpful there. Now coming to the second point, of course, like all the South publishers, I think, definitely had an uptick of around 20 to 35% of traffic in this few months. bus definitely, most followed views definitely. And what we try to do is that we try to engage audience using our offline online mix. So like Srinivasan was pointing out, we also did something which can engage both print users and the online users, something like MQs, what we call. So basically the quiz will be basically on the night time, but the question will be based on what is printed on the daily in the morning.
Okay.
So basically it actually helped us to engage both the spectrum of audience and what the uptick we are seeing on the online side. We made sure that it is getting converted to a regular users because we are a very print heavy state still.
Yudhish, do you have something to add?
Yeah. So I think everybody covered it pretty clearly. But one of the things that we noticed is obviously, like all the other websites, we also saw a spike in our traffic, and especially for the content related to the pandemic and stuff like that. See, from a digital perspective, what you should understand is a bulk of the traffic goes into content which is created from an entertainment perspective, from sports perspective, crime and stuff like that. So none of that was actually there for the last 2 months, and yet the traffic was still high. I do agree with Divya that doing a lot of hyper-local stories, especially from the news media perspective, and since we cover the news space in English, we did see a lot of spikes. And after like 1 month of the pandemic, we also started putting out a lot of positive stories because we itself got a little bit fed up. I mean, how much of COVID-related content can you actually read over a month? There is, right now, there I could obviously safely say that there has been an overdose of coverage on the pandemic. And if you want your traffic to spike up again, then you're looking at some celebrity getting COVID or something like that, So that's something that which you actually missed out from a news perspective.
This is quite interesting to hear this, right? Because I, as a user, for example, I'm South Indian, but I'm in Bombay. And I've never actually gone around looking for regional news till this came through. And now, because I hear more about what Kerala is doing, so I want to read more about it than just what Times of India gives me in like one article in page 6, right? I want to know more than that. And that's when you end up. So I did start exploring this actively. And so I would qualify in that new user category who's doing this. I want to understand if, while you guys must have culled data out of this to understand what kind of new users have come in and what is the habit. Do you think this is going to become a habit going forward? Like right now, what people are doing in terms of wanting to know regional stuff, you think going forward, once things quote unquote normalize, as they call it, will this still be a thing for people outside of the region to come back? Say somebody living in Dubai wanting to know about Kerala, somebody living in America trying to understand what's happening in Hyderabad or local thing. Do you see that uptick continuing, or is this a one-off fad?
Rohit, I have a slightly contrarian view to this.
Sure.
In fact, we have always found that hyper-local content has been the driver of views, especially from those who have moved away from that hyper-locality. Like, we have our reporters across our 32 districts in Tamil Nadu, and we have found that invariably the stories that they file about what's happening in the vicinity of their town in respect of, either some panchayats or some, temple festival or, some clashes or whatever it may be, generally it affects the people who move from there to Chennai in search of jobs or to the rest of India or to the rest of the world. So we've always found this affinity for wanting to get back to their local news as something of a driver. It may not apply so much to those who are reading it in English as much as it would be to those who are reading it still in their local language, right? So I think local newspapers and magazines typically have always thrived on this. I would, in fact, we have done the reverse of that. We have used this opportunity for pandemic. For us, user-generated content was always an important link, but we use this pandemic to talk about those who were separated from their towns or their villages, what they remembered about their towns, what they remembered about their villages or their family or their time back So they started publishing those stories, they started sending us those stories, and we started publishing them, and those started gaining a lot of traction in the local, right? So I think it's a bit of a, it's a two-way situation, and I think it has always worked for us.
Anybody else has a point of view?
So I speak only from a regional publication perspective and not from a pan-India perspective.
Yeah.
I think, see, back in the days, just 2 months back, I would say, that news websites wanted to obviously increase their traffic, see how many users they could increase month on month and stuff like that. I think what we've realized in the last 2 months is, how do I engage my audience a lot more? Even if my audience is just 1 million, how do I make sure that I keep them engaged so that they come back and return? And like what Srinivas said is, yes, a lot of people who have been away from, the south part of, at least for us, at least from South India, I do see a lot of traffic coming in from there just to understand what exactly is happening from a local perspective. I think at some point they are still connected to their roots. And Srinivas, not to take it away from you, I've seen a lot of people who can speak in Tamil and Kannada, but they can't read it. So that's where we come in.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
But I do agree that, you know, a lot of hyperlocal content, especially in the vernacular languages, is probably the way forward in terms of connecting them, you know, those people who are actually living outside as well. So,
yeah. Well, you should be syndicating some content from us for that.
Yeah. Anybody else has a point of view, or do we move forward?
Yeah, there's one small point. So basically, talking about Kerala perspective, we have some inherent advantages. So, which is basically, one was the literacy, and second was the highest internet penetration, not just next to Delhi NCR. And also, we have been traditionally people who have actually gone out and worked always. So within India and outside India, we always had a good traffic. We're talking about 200 plus geographies giving us traffic. So the hyperlocal, like earlier somebody pointed out, is very much in demand even then. It's not a COVID or post-COVID scenario. It was always there. Because you can gather your international news from a lot of sources, you can gather your national news from a lot of sources. But what is happening at your village, your small town she comes from, is not covered in anywhere. So that's what the strength of a regional local player who's well entrenched for the great news network at stringers across the state, which can cover news, which is very, very hyper local. So that scenario is already there. It's not something created by COVID, according to me.
So then, you know what? I'll just mold my question out saying, this uptake of users you've seen, do you have data, or do you know who are these new users who come in then? If it's not specifically somebody, I mean, if you're saying that, yes, people always wanted to consume hyperlocal news, this whole uptake that you've seen, why is this uptake suddenly been there? Because I understand from an OTT perspective, right? The uptake has happened because everybody's sitting at home and they have nothing else to consume. So they're looking for more content to consume. So is this uptake purely from the need to consume news that new people are coming? Do we have any form of data that tells you what are the kind of people who you've added suddenly, etc.?
The point here is definitely we keep track of where the traffic is coming from, especially from the geo point of view. So what we have generally seen is these last 2 months, this is something which has happened globally. So it is not something which is very local or certain state, something like that. So what has happened is that when people work outside of your home state and they want to know what is actually happening back at your place, what is happening to your near and dear ones, so this traffic definitely goes up. So they're more anxious. But second thing is basically, within India, there are specific cities which I don't want to name, but per newspaper distribution, however small, has got affected. So where do we catch up news on? Definitely it has to be online, right? So this traffic definitely comes as incremental. Whether they stay put, that's a strategy you have to implement to make sure that this audience just come, anybody who's coming new, how can you make them engage and stick on to with the online part of it? Right, so that's a big challenge. Like, print is already coming back in a big way. So no doubt in that.
think from a data perspective, I think it's very difficult to pinpoint and say where the new user is coming from. But I can very safely say that the medium through which the new traffic came onto our website, at least, was through WhatsApp. Okay, I think there was a lot of stories, local stories, which were being shared. See, when we, at least in the last 2 months, we started focusing on taking inputs from our readers and figuring out what kind of content we should be putting out. One of the pieces which actually went viral, at least from a Bangalore perspective, and I'm talking only urban pockets, was we did an article on the resident welfare associations, the kind of restrictions, because people wanted to know, is my maid allowed to come in? Is my house help allowed to come in? Are visitors allowed to come into my apartment? So we saw that not many people were writing on those kind of situations. You know, can I travel from Kerala to Bangalore? You know, if I don't have an emergency, but my father or my parents are in Bangalore, but I need to go and visit them. So what happens? So we started putting out a lot of informative content like that. And I'm 100% sure that, you know, the medium through which it was consumed is WhatsApp, because you're forwarding it to, you know, every single person. We obviously got feedback from resident welfare associations, how our articles were popular on their, WhatsApp groups and stuff like that. But whether they stick onto it, like what Rohit had asked, is something that I can't say right now, until we continuously keep writing content on the resident welfare association, which probably is obviously not possible. That is something that we'll have to get, wait and see. So.
So, just from a slightly broader perspective, see, look, for all our digital news publisher, all of us, direct traffic over a period of time has started to become a much smaller chunk. Large part of traffic is referral, it's lateral, whether it comes from WhatsApp, social, search, which is the biggest chunk, and I think there is a general momentum on both sides in terms of your direct traffic growing, and that's the salience of the brand and your ability to cover local stuff and that comfort with the brand, whether it's a print brand, television brand, and then that association is becomes easy. So typically you will see a 30 to 40% spike in your direct traffic. And that's also important because in an era where there is all sorts of news and fake data and everything flying around, it's important to go to news fronts where people have implicit trust in. So I think that's where the direct traffic, but a large part of the other traffic which is coming laterally is the general momentum. I mean, if you do like a quick Google Zeitgeist or a list of top search terms and all, that is very, very clear where where the general audience, what kind of stuff are they looking at. And then they hop on to the respective site. And that really is the one which is opening up a much wider set of audience. So I'll give you an example. My 18-year-old son, for example, would not do too much search beyond, let's say, English Premier League or NBA or anything. Those guys have evolved into a slightly more apt kind of an environment. But he would now these days do search on, okay, what's happening on COVID, or how the how the vaccine development stuff is going on, what company is doing what, and all those kind of things. Not necessarily only data, but that's a very different set. And then they would come to one of our news sites, and that's what validates the opening up and the access to this new consumer, which in a typical scenario, would you you expect them to come and type up your URL and visit you? Probably not. A lot less likely.
So then I think this follows the big question that's on half our minds, right? Which is the question on revenue. So which is this whole uptick in users that we're seeing across the board, etc., does that translate in an uptick in revenue at all? And if not now, do you see this eventually becoming an uptick in revenue? What is your view on monetizing this entire piece?
Go ahead.
Okay, sorry. So I'm a firm believer in reader revenues, and I have been for 15 years now. we went free in 2005, and we've been freemium, of course. We some of it we have in front of the paywall and some of it behind the paywall. I think the advertiser driven revenue is going through a lot of change, and I don't think after COVID, post COVID, I think that change is going to be pretty permanent. It's going to leave a scar on most of us, because I think end of the day, if you look at the way YouTube has surged during this time, we are a very big player on YouTube too. So for us, again, views have gone through the roof, but the CPMs have just hit the floor, if not lower, right? And the net deliverable or net revenue that we can earn from YouTube is barely 10% of what we used to earn, you know, a couple of months back. So it's actually gone nowhere. So I think there is a glut in inventory. And I think, I don't know if all the panelists are going to agree with this, but I think that inventory glut is not going to go away anytime in the near future. I think all of us, thanks to the positive reinforcement that we are all putting on engagement, on trying to keep our traffic within our app or our site, as the case may be, and giving more and more, you know, content perspectives, you know, to the users. So for example, we have selectively picked up from our archives. So when there is no entertainment news or not significant crime news, and not much of political news to go by during these 2 months, what did we do? We dug up our archives. We took, you know, content which is very, very relatable and very, you know, adaptable to the requirements of today. And then we've kept our engagement going based on that, right? So that's, you know, we found new ways of doing this. So we are expanding the pie. But that for the advertisers to meet that expanded pie, it's going to take a while. So I firmly believe that, for example, in the next couple of months, we are thinking of going completely behind the paywall, right? We believe that reader revenues has to be the way forward, because it may be difficult. It may be, you know, an impossibility of performance. It may be actually something which seems like a no-go. But if we don't do it now, I would say that we've lost a historic opportunity, because we've got users, we've got them engaged, and we've actually kind of understood how to consistently keep them engaged, even at a time when news cycle is relatively down. So how do we monetize out of this? And the advertiser should be the icing on the cake, not the bread and butter itself. So if we're going to flip that equation, I think we'll manage. Well, whether we're able to do that, you will know in some time.
Yeah, I agree. It's time. This is the right time to go behind paywalls and subscriptions. Like Mr. Srinivasan said, yes, we have proved that we are able to engage our users and get so many more. So we've actually, in our regional space, we haven't gone behind the wall. We haven't had subscriptions, not even paid subscriptions, haven't even had any subscriptions. But now we're in talks with our competitors, so that we could all come into consensus and come up with the pricing plan, so all of us can go behind the paywall simultaneously, especially for the e-paper. So I totally agree that the revenues have to come from the readers now. The spends are going to be very, very small and smart and targeted. That gives web the upper hand over paper and TV, where, you know, we're able to give targeted ads, but still the spends are going to be quite small is what I feel. That being said, we are seeing an upswing after the fall already. A lot of clients have expressed their interest to advertise, because they want people to know that they are back in business and they are ready to start their online businesses. Many clients have moved from storefronts to online businesses, and they want to advertise their businesses now. And we're also in talks with some of the clients who have moved this way to digital to provide them IT services to put up their websites, you know, the e-commerce websites quickly. So we're trying newer revenue models with existing clients, and that's all in the works now. So it's going to be a different kind of revenue model for all of us, and we have to explore some more options and experiment with some more things before we see anything like before.
Yeah, so on the monetization bit, I come with a bit of ad network background, so this is something turf which I understand pretty well. So you talk about any large platforms, it's a pretty much walled garden. What is actually going inside, nobody knows. What the dashboard is throwing is what you're talking about, right? So that has been the way it has been. Now, how we can try to address this or reduce the damage is, you know, we always as a organization believe direct selling is something which gives us the best yield. I think everybody will agree, because the kind of yields I get from direct sales deals are at least 5-6 times more than what I get from any platform or any network. Now, yes, last 50-60 days, if you look at how the eCPMs were plummeting because the traffic was going through the roof, so much page views are getting generated, but so only players who are spending at the time are basically people who have something to do with health and wellness, online entertainment, online education, you know, hyperlocal essential supplies and things like that. Pretty much others were very cautious, you know, almost not spending. So this dip is almost seen everywhere, not only individual smaller publishers, even large platforms. There are some reports, quarterly results which has come out, which shows a minimal dip, like 4-5%. But they always do quarter on quarter. This first time they've gone by -4-5% in short, maybe 2-3 years. I have not seen any big growth happening in any platform. But so that crunch situation is always there. Definitely, there are two things which is going to evolve the business. So one is basically definitely you have to quantize your readers better. Then your first-party data which you gather out of that is going to be very, very crucial in the business, because that has implication on how targeted you're going to show the ads with all the permissions. Especially the cookie policy is also changing maybe in a year's time. So basically, developing this, you know, reader data plus first-party data together is going to be very, very crucial for, you know, growth and survival of all the publishers. That's my point of view.
I think there's two more aspects. You know, one is the fact that yes, there is an audience search, but it's actually on back of largely what we call the negative news. You know, which is not the best environment for most advertisers to be even looking at favorably. You know, just from a traditional brand spends or banners and all of those traditional forms of advertising. And hence, one of the interesting way to leverage this audience or whatever you are able to retain out of it on long term is how you're able to give custom solution and engaged, a lot more entrenched advertising opportunity to users, or create pools within your own network which are specialized. So, for example, stuff like creating a series around India Positive. So, as you come out of it, already looking ahead, how future of work will change, how things will evolve from the traditional offices to people working remotely, getting experts to come and talk about that. So, you know, the fact that you've created a platform with this massive audience, if you are able to enable a lot of these conversations, then the brands become interested. But as Mr. Srinivasan said, you know, yes, it will be a while before they come back to the levels that we've been used to in terms of brand, because the larger macroeconomic environment is such that everyone's feeling the stress on the consumer side. There is
there are pay cuts, there is loss of jobs, there are general fear psychosis to trying to save. The leveraged lifestyle is a lot more prevalent than it was, let's say, 10, 15 years ago when our parents were working and sort of doing jobs and all that. So I think all of those things will take, that entire confidence will take a little bit of time to come back. And on back of that, hopefully the advertising, which typically we say is the first to go and last to come back, and hopefully some of that will change and we'll see the momentum.
Yeah, it's great that you guys actually touched upon this, because this was my second point, right? Where the other point that I wanted to speak about was paywall. And what was interesting, what you brought up, Mr. Srinivasan, about paywall, and what is really interesting, what you brought up, Divya, as well, is that it's something that you guys are talking with your competition as well. So it's almost like, it's not like I can go under a paywall without my competition being, because maybe I will lose my... So it has to be a collective effort of sorts, right? So, and that's a interesting take on this. Also, keeping... I'm just trying to understand, going under the paywall has been a key question across the board. And I'm sure because of COVID, etc., we're saying that we could look at an accelerated path to it. The other side, which Puneet also touched upon, is revenues in terms of, even from a people perspective, right? There have been job cuts, there have been salary cuts, etc. Suddenly, if I have to now pay for what I was accessing earlier for free or anything, how do you think user behavior would deal with something like that? And do you also see various methods? Are you going to form a different revenue model in terms of, is it a full subscription model, or can you pay per article? Have you guys thought of anything of that sort as well on this front? Because if I've always got something for free, and suddenly today when my incoming revenue is low, and if you ask me to open my purses, it does, the question does pose in my head, right?
So, the way we have done it is, you can literally on our site and on our app, you can buy a single magazine issue, and you can pay as low as 15 rupees for that, and you can go right up to 12,999 for a lifetime subscription, and you've got everything in between, right? And you've got ebooks, you've got your trial subscription packs, you've got your monthly subscription packs, you've got your annual packs. There are actually a whole range of things. And so the way we do it is that not just that we offer so many options, we have, as Bobby was mentioning, data as important as data and analytics is important for the advertiser. That data is exactly what tells us what is the propensity for a potential potential customer of ours to pay. So we have what is called a propensity to pay algorithm, which tells us, based on their visits to our site, based on their consumption pattern, it tells us what package to be able to tailor make for which user, and to deliver with what kind of messaging and what offer at what point of time, right? And that is it's a kind of an AI engine which keeps understanding better based on making a postulate, making somebody actually trying to understand what is the potential for somebody to make a purchase, and then finding out whether that actually goes through, and then, the entire the full monty. So we have inside sales team, we have our email database, we've got an SMS database, we're able to, app engagement through Facebook and other places. We are actually able to tap the user depending on their propensity to pay, and we are improving on that algorithm, every day as we move along. So I probably haven't answered the question that you asked about, at a time like this, do you expect your user to pay? So I would say data would give us a much better picture. So for example, data tells us if this user has gone to an e-commerce website within the last 2 months, right? So it will give us a little bit of his or her ability to open up the wallet to us. Yeah. So these are, we have multiple factors that actually help us understand whether this user is capable of paying.
Also, I think, you know, one of the key aspects in any subscription business is the kind of value you are able to give to the user. You know, if he's paying for a certain service, what does he get? You know, and he gets, what does he get when he comes in, and what are the likely improvements over a period of time so that, you are able to ensure that he stays with you, you know. Making that first sale is a lot easier than retaining users for the longer term. And I feel, you know, if you're able to come up with a value proposition which is aligned with what the user sort of needs are, and what the general sort of audience is looking at, and constantly keep on improving it, it helps quite a lot. You know, and I'll just give a quick example of Money Control, which I was talking briefly about before we started. You know, we started Money Control about a year back, and you know, in wake of a fair bit of pushback, you know, why are we doing it? What is the value proposition? Is it only ads free? You know, that's not value enough, and all of those things. Cut to that to a stage where we now over 250,000 paying subscribers, and you know, and we added between, as I said, 21st April, which was the first anniversary, in about 20 days period, we added 50,000 new subscribers. And so yes, we started with an ad-free product, and then over a period of time, we got differentiated content, insights, a lot of data, a lot of analysis, and all of it. And that's something which has constantly, constantly been evolved. You know, on an average, there are two or three product upgrades or new features that we are launching every month. And under the circumstances where personal finance, savings, money has become a very, very important part of the consideration set and the thought process of every individual, it's sort of seen that traction where more and more people are trying to access it, getting the subscription. The other thing that if you're able to give the value, you know, when we started, we had a 1 month subscription, quarterly, half yearly, 1 year subscription, and we sort of over a period of time, what we did was we phased out to 2 or 3 years. So, for example, we've done away with a couple of sets, and because data showed us, as Mr. Srinivasan pointed out, you know, studying that data, and data showed us that even in the initial terms, almost 47% of our users were on annual plans. So clearly, that was an indicator for us to make the pricing decisions and sort of run promotions and offers from that.
So I speak entirely from a general news website perspective. So we've obviously been debating whether we should go behind a paywall or we shouldn't go behind a paywall. Personally, you know, I feel that, you know, the legacy media players, when they started their digital versions, they gave everything for free. And so the consumer mentality is such that, you know, why should we pay for general news? So changing the perception is going to take a lot longer than what, you know, I would expect. So from the News Minute perspective, we would probably never go behind a paywall, especially when it comes to our content. But having said that, we did launch a membership model of sorts. Basically, this is an annual membership where the person who's a very engaged reader of TNM, who likes us for what we do and likes our content and has been interacting with us, you know, on a regular basis. So we are basically adding a lot more products which are individualized to the person who's actually going to become a member. So none of the content is going to go behind the paywall, but we are exploring with something like this so that, you know, we can keep the user engaged, obviously make, you know, we're also looking at lifetime membership models and stuff like that, wherein the user gets a lot more different kind of access. None of the content, like I said, would be behind the paywall, but this would be more on a relationship building, you know, basis from TNM and the reader as well. And like what Puneet said, that, see, you have to have some kind of specialized content. I've always argued this, that, you know, if you're going to be in the general news space, if you're debunking a lot of fake news, and then that's going to be behind a paywall, then what are you trying to, who are you trying to help?
Like, you know, you tapped on the elephant in the room, the fake news spectrum, right?
Yeah.
Which I think it's impact. Just before we started this panel, we were having a discussion where Srinivasan himself brought out that fake news impacting a news publication in itself, because it's fake news about how COVID would spread through the paper, and then suddenly it's like, just tell me, I'm trying to understand from how has technology in general come and changed the game here in the news spectrum for you guys? Has just to move away from the current topic on this, is how important a role is tech playing, and now going forward with more and more people reading this online, what is the role that you see tech playing? So one is, do you see tech helping solve for the fake news problem that exists? Is that something that, are you able to understand, gather the kind of data, and then craft news specifically to people? Because I was talking to somebody and they mentioned that, hey, we craft news basis the audience that reads us. So if you read a certain kind of news, I give you only that news. For me, that was a problem, because that I end up becoming a frog in the wall, in the well, right? It's almost like an echo chamber that you're making. So how is, and that really helps as an advertiser, but from a news publication, how is tech helping? Tech, data, all of these keywords that are thrown out, helping you guys?
Yeah, I think personalized news or individualized news is one of the most abused words, in this entire process. The way I think we should look at it, and the way at least we have been attempting to look at it, is pretty much like how Amazon does their recommendations to you. So when you just go for the first time, you log into Amazon and you browse for a book, you don't get only the same titles or, you know, titles in the same genre. They look at people who bought this also bought this, right? So that's the starting point. And then that algorithm keeps working on your choices and keeps trying to expand those choices for you based on your interests, but also based on the kind of persona that you hold within that community. I think that is the approach we are taking for personalization of the news feed. We are working on a model by which we believe at some point of time, we should be able to get to n is equal to 1, which basically means, like Alibaba says, every customer has a different website, you know, for Alibaba. I don't think we'll ever get there, but I'm saying if at all we could reach for that, it would be only based on tech and our ability to garner tech and create enough diversity, but give a relatively personalized news feed to every one of our customers. Just to give you a small example, while we do not want data to make us like Roald Dahl's The Great Giant, grammatizer, right? We don't want to put words and get a story out of it. That's not what we're looking for from tech. But what we are looking for from tech is, at what time of the day do a certain demographic of an audience consume a certain type of content? And therefore, how can we encourage our newsrooms to develop and present such kind of content at such points of time? This is already happening. And I won't say this is driving our consumption or engagement, but it is certainly enhancing it, right? So tech helps in multiple ways. I think tech must be used as an enabler. Tech cannot be the driver. We do not believe that tech is going to drive our news cycle, but tech can enable us to get to the right customers with the right kind of content at the right time.
Anybody else have a build on this?
See, the question that you asked in the email was specifically with artificial intelligence. If it's artificial intelligence, then I'd like to say no. Obviously, every website aims to, you know, to make sure that, you know, if you're reading a particular piece of content, you try to feed in a lot more. You know, about 2 or 3 years back, we did a small exercise where I think it was during the times of Jayalalitha, who was not well. There was a lot of Jayalalitha content on every single website. So deliberately, we have an infinite scroll platform. So when you read an article, the next article, you know, gets pulled up. And that is based on what your interests are. So just to tweak it a bit, we put an entertainment copy. Okay. And we realized the amount of the completion rate for that entertainment copy was a lot higher. So it's not necessarily always that you have to feed content which, you know, the people are supposed to read. As an editor, you know, we should obviously be able to have the freedom to say that, hey, some content has to be, you know, read. See, from a social media perspective, I've seen a lot of the good, longer ground reported pieces that we do being shared on Facebook and Twitter and, you know, with a nice status. If I look at my analytics, 1,000 people would have read that story. You take the same thing, flip it aside and say that Deepika Padukone did something. It would not be shared on social media, but I'll give you a guarantee that I would have about a lakh of people who actually read that. So that's where the mentality of a reader is. So, you know, how you try to define and use artificial intelligence or technology. So that's one side of it. The other thing is, you know, we are trying to actually innovate from a client perspective. You know, how do we increase our business and revenue through technology? So we're right now focusing on segmented advertising, right? We feel that, you know, after the pandemic, I mean, the lockdown is now opened up. We see a lot of local businesses who want to advertise, who have some kind of money, but obviously they cannot reach out to the newspapers and stuff like that. So they are going to obviously come to the digital platforms. Now, it doesn't make any sense for me to advertise those brands to a pan-India audience.
Yeah.
We have started looking at segmenting and saying that if it's Chennai, why can't we just advertise only to an audience in Chennai? So that, you know, there is a lot of return of investment for the brand itself. And the clients are a lot more happy to at least shell out some kind of money because they're saying that it's not wasted inventory like anywhere else where I just put it somewhere for eyeballs. Rather than that, I'm actually able to get some engagement in the area or locality that I'm actually situated in. So obviously, these are the tech enhancements that we are actually doing at our end. But from a readership, I mean, from creating content, like what Srinivas said, you cannot use technology to debunk fake news. Because in a very polarized environment like what we are in right now, you can get 10 different articles debunking it. You can get 10 different articles actually justifying it. So I think from a technology perspective, it will never work out.
Yeah, I have a small point to make here. So I just want to quote an example. There are a couple of days there was news that Microsoft has done away with a few newsrooms within the Amazon.com portal. I don't know if any one of you have read this. This is a couple of days back. So what is happening here is when you are a large horizontal website, there are tons of content coming in. Little bit of personalization always helps. I'm not talking about over-personalization, but a little bit of personalization. Now, it will never match up with the curated content which the editors and news producers are putting up. Why? Because each news actually has put up with certain kind of emotions behind it, right? When you put up a news, there is happiness, there is anguish, there is despair, there is are you nuts kind of emotions. When people read it also, they exude same kind of emotions. So that cannot be done by any machine. So obviously the curated content done by humans is going to stay, especially in the case of generic news and kind of stuff. But where to win is basically sections where you have definite information, definite results. For example, sports. In sports, what matters is basically, you know, who has won, what is the score. These are definite answers, right? So this kind of things, automations will come. But generic news is very, very difficult.
I wish we could go on. Sorry, you're saying something.
Divya, I think it can be used to gather data for your story, but not to write your story.
No.
Well, I wish we could go on and ask further questions. I think it's 4:30 and we are close. Simran, can you help us? Are there any other questions from our viewers, etc., that you want to throw out, or should we wrap this session here because it's already 4:30 and I guess some people had a hard stop.
We do have some questions. If you're all okay, we could take them. First, what alternative revenue models could you possibly look for?
I think the questions that have come in the Q&A section, a few of them have already been answered. So maybe you should pick and choose.
Just one. For Mr. Puneet, how is the subscription worked out for MoneyControl? If you could just throw some highlight on that. How is it worked out for MoneyControl.com? And what has been the growth in it?
Yeah, in fact, I answered to Bhavesh privately also. You know, as I said later on, that you know, it's been quite a phenomenal growth for us during the period and in general through the year. You know, and that's because we've been able to give an incremental value every month, and specifically during this period, we saw almost a 30-40% spike in the paying subscribers coming to MoneyControl.
Another question from Bhavesh, which is, how are publications going to manage the change in third-party cookies being depreciated? What impact do you think it will have on ad revenue?
I think tech is already working on this because this is something that's been in the works for a while. For us personally, if you see, we have a DMP. So, you know, the level of data that we get using the DMP as a backend is extremely efficient. And it is, from what I'm told from our, you know, DMP supplier, is that, you know, we are future safe from that perspective. So I think just doing it through the third-party cookies of the old ways, I don't think that is going to work in the future in any case.
And just if you could all just give your final thoughts on how do you see the industry evolving going ahead? You have spoken about it, but what would be your key takeaway from COVID, and how do you see that, how do you see your company particularly evolving, retaining the consumer, most importantly, going ahead? Just final thoughts. Divya?
Yeah, so I think, yeah, we talked about it. There's definitely a change. Spends, advertising spends are going to be smaller. And we as a company, as you know, we are looking at other ways and changing our revenue models, where we are trying to be more of IT partners for some of our clients. We're looking at affiliate marketing. We are also considering paid subscriptions for our e-papers, which we haven't done so far. So these are some of the revenue models that we are exploring at this point. When and how far it will come back to how it used to be is still to be seen. Thank you.
Bobby, what about you? What can we expect from Manorama Online?
Can somebody repeat the question? It's very feeble.
What can we expect from Manorama Online looking ahead? From Manorama.
I guess she's saying, what's the new normal for Malayalam Manorama, Bobby?
Okay.
That's for all of us.
See, new normal is pretty much, we are a very localized, right? So our core strength is Malayalam as a language and Kerala as a state. Wherever there is so our audience, of course, is a small right now. This is for specifically put for our second generation Malayalis, like somebody has mentioned, they can speak Malayalam, but they read and write. So this led us to that. Now coming to the question, see, new normal is something which actually got into a fast phase mode because of the situation we are put into, right? Now, the social distancing, work from home, there are a lot of things which actually happened, which actually is augmenting what was supposed to happen in maybe 2-3 years. It actually fastened the process. Now, for the traditional players like us, the biggest challenge is to balance both traditional and modern, or online, medium. Because still, for print for us is still growing. We are talking about 25 lakhs copies plus every day, right? We are already on the top 10 newspapers in the world. From such a small state, thanks to our literacy, maybe. But thing is that it's going to be a little fast-paced, but the media will still grow in India because print has a long shelf life in India. Second one, coming to the other medium, what will happen is that there is a bit of convergence which is definitely happening already, which will actually make in a very fast pace. Now you're talking about radio stations, it will go, say, internet radio, they have to explore, television, already they're doing an OTT and that kind of stuff. So this kind of convergence media will definitely take a lead now. But traditional media is pretty much going to be there. And they're still 90% of our revenues.
Ritesh, what about you? Just your last
impression. Yeah. So I think from a digital only perspective, I think all those strategies that you started when you actually started the organization, you put out these nice Excel sheets and strategies saying that how you need to build your audience, how you need to increase your number of page views, how you need to put the relevant content to make sure that you increase that page views, and that would obviously convert into revenues. Now, I think the last 2 months we've realized post-pandemic, we've realized that situation is obviously not happening. So how do we actually start reinventing the entire process right now? So we've taken a call to make sure that we are a lot more engaged with our regular reader, and how do we make sure that we can convert that reader into a paying customer who can support our journalism at the end of the day. So that's what we are actually working towards right now.
Mr. Puneet, what about you? How, where would the growth area come for you, or particularly on the digital front, because you have various sectors also within your within the larger network 18 digital platform. So if you could just tell us what your thoughts on that.
I think the fact that we have television, such a big television network, it actually complements and helps the digital growth. But specifically on digital, two or three things. One is the way we work and the way we operate will be completely getting transformed over a period of time, and that's true for all of us. And I think from an audience perspective, yes, these are spikes. Will they stay? Probably not. But I think as we go along, the audience that we are able to retain and people who stay with us will definitely add on a completely new layer of audience, which traditionally in a normal environment would have required a lot of marketing dollars with very, very little ROI. And I think the third thing is it will fundamentally change how we are engaging with our advertisers. There will be the traditional kind of advertising that will keep happening, but I think the differential value is where you are able to deliver scale and engagement for the advertiser, not only in form of branding, but it also in form of enabling conversations, because that's starting to become a lot more important for all the advertisers.
And finally, Mr. Srinivas, you've been a big proponent of digital. So what I want to know is, you're one of the first to go behind the paywall with your subscriptions, with content behind paywall. So when do you see digital, giving your print revenues run for their money, and when do you see digital?
Yeah, that's a great question. I have to admit this. When COVID started and the 3 weeks that we actually didn't reach the customer, we completely went blank. Till then, I think we must have taken print for granted because there was so much coming in and everything was gung ho. The moment the print revenue stopped, we just hit a blank wall. And then after 3 weeks, when we started printing and people started buying it, and then everything started going back to at least a reasonable level of normalcy, I think we've come to understand that digital is here meant to supplement, complement, and append to everything that we do in print. And we also believe that for the first time, digital has driven print consumption. So we actually were able to tell our readers where you can find your copies, when you can find your copies, and how to reach out to your agents and pick up your copies. So we found a lot of synergies between the two, and I believe we are going to be completely working between the two. I think it will take a few years still for digital to overtake print. I think that's going to still take a while. But digital, last year, we closed with 20% of our revenues coming in from digital. And this year, we believe that we will be able to, you know, go close to 28 to 30% of our revenues coming in from digital. So, of course, the markets have to open up and COVID has to, you know, get back to some degree of normalcy. But the two things that we've completely learned is, how can I move my fixed cost to become my variable cost? Which means, how do I attribute my cost to a revenue so that when the revenue doesn't come, I can cull my cost? You know, if we don't get this act together, I think we are really going to be in troubled times. This is one big lesson that COVID has taught me. And the second thing is, there is, you know, your customer or your client comes before everything else. So as far as the customer or our client is concerned, we will do everything in our power to be able to make his investment work for him. So what can we do to provide max ROI to our customer, especially at a time like this, to our clients, especially at troubled times like this? For that, you know, we've started, you know, we've even got a little bit into Rohit's way. We've started, you know, coming out with creatives for advertisements. We've started shooting advertisement commercials. We used to be only in, you know, the production of TV serials and in OTT platform. Now we've started shooting ads. You know, we've started using our, you know, our social media to promote those ads. So there's a whole load of things that we can do for our customers, for our clients. And I believe as long as we leave no stone unturned, create more and more opportunities for revenue and make sure that you're able to map every item of cost to a revenue, which can be groomed or culled, then I think we should be on a decent wicket. That is the new normal for me.
Rohit, you have competition, but also your team from here. And if you were to, you know, advise your brands on digital news, how they could, you know, add more, or rather, how could a digital news platform add value to your brands? Any specific thing that you'd like to mention?
No, we've worked very closely with a bunch of brands. Actually, I've been in conversation with Vignesh's team as well on this, where we try and see how, I mean, so far what we've done is, we brands and news networks, we kind of make ancillary content with it. So say, for example, if you're promoting a show on Netflix, which is about, say there's a show called Jamtara, which was on the fake calls that you were getting, the phishing calls, we tied up with news networks, etc., to kind of bring the story of Jamtara, bringing the story of phishing and how that has impacted, etc. So to kind of generate interest in the show. So there's always been ancillary programming that we do around with news channels, news networks, etc., to promote shows, products, and things. So that has happened in the past. I think that'll only get stronger going forward, because see, the thing is, I think the days of people, nobody goes searching for an ad, right? People are going looking for content, and sometimes that content happens to be an ad, and that's what it is. And nobody makes content better than news networks that are sitting here. So this is content that people are actively looking for. And if we can put ourselves in there and at least pass off some form of communication, so be it. That's where we are at.
Thank you so much, gentlemen and the lady, for taking time out. It was really insightful. We got to learn a lot. Thank you so much for taking your time out.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming, guys.
Thanks, guys. Bye.
Bye.